so honored to be accepted again by the music community. Thank you so much for having me back. We're honored to be here. And we want this new record to fucking really fucking do well. We want you to buy it, and we want you to share it with all your friends. Bieber out the way unless you guys do something, you know what I'm saying? Hey, he's a cute kid, and I'm sure he's really happy and everything, but you know, I'm talking about substance and shit, you know? Like, this song is about getting naked on an airplane and trying to fucking make sense of it, you know what I'm saying? I live a crazy life, and I'm proud of it. Better than that.
Call the gonzo music making phase of my life. Amalgama was really where it was off the chain. But Short Bus and all that stuff. I used to take acid in the middle of winter in Cleveland and go to the city center, and we get underneath the transportation bridge. We'd shimmy our way to the top of a beam that would go underneath the road. So it was an access road underneath the road. So all you'd hear is cars just driving back and forth over you, and you were underneath them. And you'd sit there and be on acid and stare at the city and, like, just, you know, think about shit like that.
There it is, the transportation bridge. That access road right underneath the main bridge. I would go up there with my friends, and we would look out at the city and trip on psilocybic drugs.
Those were the formative years of, like, you know, why do people fall through the cracks of society? You know, I have members of my family that aspired to have the polo shirt collection and, you know, the BMW and you know, the professional title in the corner office. That totally wasn't the way that I wanted to live my life. And that was kind of a prison on its own. You know, and then there was the artistic side, and I used to sit there in Cleveland and I'd go, like, you know, acid's cheap. You take one hit, you're gone for 12 hours on a, you know, an adventure. But we'd come off that bridge and then we'd walk into another part of the city. And there was this old abandoned jail. We'd break our way in through some you know, plywood, you know, thing that the bums would, you know, get into. And we'd open it, go in, and we'd be on acid on that, you know, like in there. There'd be a homeless guy, and he would be scared of us, and we'd be scared of him. But we would, look, we're just passing through. And we'd, like, get all the way down to the basement of the jail and have flashlights. And then we'd open up these filing cabinets and look up, like, our birthdays. May 10th, 1920, three people were murdered and this guy was arrested. And we'd go in through all these records. And, you know, you're just sitting there in this abandoned jail in Cleveland. And you're on acid and you're thinking to yourself, like, what the fuck is life about? Like, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? You know, and all those guys, actually, that I used to hang out with, most of them are exactly the same. Like, just frozen in 1993, tripping on drugs and practically homeless. Frank was one of those guys. Frank actually joined the Army after that. Frank Cavanaugh, after he was in Filter, he made something of himself. But there were so many other people that was like, we were these cool kids because we were just on the fringes of society, just writing our own, you know, books on how to avoid the other prison, which was just, you know, trying to make it in the rat race, you know, trying to make it in the corporate or the school or whatever it was, just like trying to avoid all that, the hassle of like being responsible. For me, my thing was like, I was literally kind of going through the shows to get to the party. Like, okay, in an hour and a half from now, I'll be able to party without feeling guilty about being high or drunk. And that's when I realized, and it was only about a year. It was about a year. It was actually one tour where I was just like, you know what, this is fucked. And I don't have control of my life, and this isn't the way I wanted it to be. And when I went into rehab, for me, it was just like, I looked at it and I was like, you know, take a good look around, because this is going to be your first time and your last time, you know, and this is done, this is over. And that's the thing, I don't know what it takes for people to get it. You know, everybody talks about how they're going to get sober. You know, when they confront me or when they talk to me about it, I'm like, well, you gotta go to meetings and you gotta do all this shit that they tell you to do. And no matter how fucking lame it seems, you gotta do it. 27th, those were like the worst fucking moments of my life, because I would look out at the audience. And they weren't looking at me like, yeah. I mean, they, you know, you walk out on stage and it was, yeah, fuck yeah, Richard Patcher, holy shit. What happened to that guy? You know, and it just goes from this enthusiasm to, let's watch the train wreck. And I never wanted to take advantage of an audience like that ever again. I've seen other people do it. I know this guy who played some huge venue in New Jersey, and we opened up for him. And he had the crowd waiting for an hour and a half. And then after that hour and a half, he came on, and all the people that worked at this big, huge facility had to stay late, and the band ended up getting charged like $60,000 because they were all way over. And you have to start charging. Plus all these parents, you know, that probably wanted to go home at 10 o'clock are now there until 2 o'clock in the morning, and you know, and they're working security, and they've got to be there for their kids when they wake up, you know, and you know, it just, to me, it's like, that's fucking where it's just like, you know, you're not a rock star, now you're just being a dick, you know what I mean, now you're just being a fucking dick. But there were other guys, like Joe Strummer was together enough, you know, he was together enough. His illness was just, he had a bad heart, he had a weird heart condition. But Mick Jagger and Bono are like the only two guys. And Bono's a big Christian guy. He's a big, you know, Christian dude, which is, to me, it's kind of a bummer, because I'm an atheist, and I think that religion has actually held us back. And, well, I know for a fact it's held us back. And just, you know, ask the people that were at the, you know, the Library of Alexandria in Egypt, when they had all that figured out. They had everything figured out. They knew what gravity was. They knew how big the earth was. They knew all that stuff. Honestly, there's nothing else I'd rather do than do music. There's nothing. Being the rock musician is the best part of life that, like, I always wanted. And unfortunately, the addiction was what slowed it down, because the addiction actually turned into the job. But that was only for a couple of years. That was, you know, the amalgamate phase, you know. And unfortunately, when I went into the amalgamate, like when I went into rehab, you know, I I came out, and the amalgam of record had kind of come and gone, and you can't work a record from rehab, and the record company doesn't want to put more money into it than it already has.